And you actually feel like you're like in a Linux, right? And it's gonna show my configuration, guys. So it shows like a Java location. It's gonna show much more partitions. Why? Hey guys, and welcome to a new episode of Nomadic Dmitry channel. I'm very excited about this episode because today we're gonna discuss Linux tools available for Mac. And the Linux tools is not exactly the right term, because what I actually mean is that it's open source tools available for Mac. And it's like Unix tools, Linux tools and all together. Well, the reason why I'm bringing this topic is because macOS 10 is especially open to outside world. So this was the system designed from the ground up to be able to actually use all the advantages of the Unix kind of systems, comparing to, like, let's say macOS 9, which was completely closed down to the specific hardware and specific vendors. It was very, very limited operating system in that sense. Quite honestly, it was not the best designed operating system. I have actually a video about the macOS 9 in my experience using it, so if you want, you go check it out. I actually have an iMac G4 I used it on. Either way, today our topic is Linux tools available for Mac. As you can see, guys, I've spent quite a while making this presentation to make it beautiful, so if you guys like it, please consider subscribing and watching my later videos. Believe me, we're gonna discuss a lot of interesting things. I feel very passionate about this topic. So let's go. Today we're gonna discuss three things basically. First of all, it's gonna be package management. To be specific, we're gonna discuss how package management is done in macOS 10. It's an interesting topic. Not many people actually discuss it those days, because what I see is that people are usually like just specifying the tools that you can use and not how you can actually install those tools. Like, this topic is not really discussed, so I decided why not just to make like overall kind of overview video of the tools available on the market, so you can decide for yourself. Then we're gonna discuss recommended packages to install, because there are a specific set of packages that I specifically like to recommend. You are totally free to overview those. If you like, you can even observe, because there's a lot of tools available actually, and this is just an example. And this is a very exciting thing to discuss as well, so we'll discuss this one. And we're also gonna discuss the Mac specific commands. Basically, guys, this is the commands that used only on the Mac. You will not find those commands on the Linux system, so we're gonna discuss those kind of things as well. So let's go. When we talk about installing Linux applications on Mac and like open source applications of Mac, there are actually multiple ways to do so. Quite honestly, it's like those approaches totally depend on what you're exactly trying to achieve. So because it all comes down to one point, you just want the application to be running and doing the specific task you want, right? You just pick the right tools that you need. That's it. When it comes to running Linux and Unix apps on a Mac, there are five options basically, right? And the most common option that is used on a Mac, it's installing those apps directly. So basically, you download this open source app and you install it on your machine and you run it. That's it. It may be in different flavors, different varieties of packages available, but it all comes down to one thing. You just have a binary, you install it, and you run it. That's it. So you install it directly, either by drag and dropping or installing the package. Second option is MacPorts. Third option is Fink. Fourth option is Homebrew. And the last option is compiling. So we're gonna discuss all this MacPorts, Fink, and Homebrews, but about compiling, actually, you can actually compile apps to run on your Mac machine like you do on Linux and Unix. Basically, there is no magic, you just compile it from the sources and it runs. So let's discuss actually the most popular options of package management, because installing directly and compiling, well, it's totally obvious for the most part. So direct install, as I said, basically there is no package management here. You just download the package and you install your machine. And a good example, for example, GIMP. You can download this and try for yourself. This is the application from the Linux community, from the open source community. And as you can see, this is a screenshot from the website. You can just download and install it directly. One thing I should just note, guys, is that previously many of those apps required X11 environment to run. And X11 environment is basically like window management system for the Linux operating system. And then many of those apps in the past required it to be installed on your Mac. Mac. But right now, they all try to integrate everything in the one package, so you don't need to bother with all those. And it actually makes sense. I mean, there are advantages of this approach as well. Usually you see those apps and those types is like PKG. You just install this through the like typical installer and then the app. Basically you have application and you just drag and drop to the application folder. This is very simple. So GIMP is a regular application and it's a good example of such tools. You can try yourself and see how it works. There is no magic at all. MacPorts. This is the option I personally used how many years ago? It was like 14 years ago, maybe something like that. As you can see on the screen, there is a screenshot of the manual page of MacPorts with the description. Basically, it's quite simple. You just install the MacPorts package on your machine locally, and after you install it, you're able just to execute the command port install and name of the package. Easy as that. Actually, in many ways, it's even easier than just like downloading the package from the internet, doing so something like this. No, you just type port install in the name of the package. The original name of this was Darwin Ports. Probably like the old-time Mac users still remember this tool, and maybe they still use it. So because it's like it's still relevant too. I honestly don't use it that much, but I'm gonna tell you why. So the next option, Fink. So Fink option is a bit different. It's also a package management system, and you can also install the apps in those similar manner. Just Fink install the name of the package. But the difference is that, guys, this one is not maintained. You can actually go on the website and see for yourself. It says for the recent macOS versions, you just need to actually compile it from sources. There is no binary installer for this one. So while it's still available, even looking on the website, you can see that this is not really actively maintained. You can see from the UI of the website, you can actually figure out if the tool is maintained or not. And this one, since it mentions PowerPC is the main option there, I mean, guys, you can probably guess that is not actively maintained, but I guess it still has some specific use cases. So if you're actually considering this one, why not? You can try to build this from sources if you wanted. But I mean, there are other tools, as I mentioned. Installation process is similar. You just type this Fink install in the command line after you have this Fink installed on your system, and that's it, and it works. And the Homebrew. Homebrew is the one I use the most. This is the one that is recommended by many developers, many advanced users of the Mac. This is basically, you feel like you're using like some variety of Linux system basically. You just, again, type brew install in name of the package. This is it. And website is quite modern. Website also includes a huge repository of the applications available. So you can just go to brew.sh website and see for yourself. It's actually very easy. You can just discover all the packages available for your system. Brew install and name of the package, boom, that's it. There are also like tools to fix some of the packages. For example, if you have something wrong with the package, you can type brew doctor or something, and this command gonna examine the packages and fix those. Brew upgrade to update the application, and there you can see brew update, sorry, and a brew list to see all the installed formulas. So basically the packages installed on the Homebrew system are called formulas basically. Well, you can guess it by the name Homebrew. There are multiple brew packages available. So this is cool. This is the one to use on the modern days Macs. This is very recent. This is like the most popular one. So use this one if you like starting out. So this is my recommendation. And let's talk about recommended packages, because we discussed the tools you can use. You can pick any you want, but I would probably go with Brew by default. What are the packages you can install with all those tools? Well, the htop. htop is the module I installed by default on any Mac. So basically, once I installed Brew, I installed this package. This allows me to see available memory, the resources that I used, like kill the applications that are not responding or something like that. You can just like basically discover the whole thing, the whole point, what's going on with your system. So you can see the CPU usage and stuff like that. Very good thing, and totally makes sense to install it too. Next one is MC. In one of my videos, I actually mentioned this is the type of the app you install and never use, because much more beautiful tools available for Mac that you can use by default. But this one is like, why not? You can use the MC, the good old Midnight Commander, which is like flies on your every system. It's like very, very fast. So totally makes sense to use this one still, because it allows you to copy files, delete files, do some like renaming operations. And as you can see on the screenshot, it actually shows you the hidden files, which is very good. Yeah, there are some configuration options available there. So yeah, good one. Next one is nmap. This is the kind of tool which is used by many network enthusiasts. After you install nmap, like Brew install nmap, you can scan your network, find vulnerabilities in your network, see the open ports and stuff like that. Like, this is a very useful tool. Well, this tool is included in many Linux distros by default, which, like, this is the reason probably you should have it on your system. If you are doing some network administration stuff, I mean, you already know about this tool already. This is the great tool. Gedit. Guys, well, you can not only install the terminal applications on using those tools, right? You can also use this tool, like Brew, for example, to install the graphic applications, like, say, this one, Gedit. And Gedit was my favorite terminal application back in Linux. And I mean, I'm still using Linux. This one is great. So you can just, like, install your favorite tools from Linux world here, which is great. Gedit works fine. It's a default text editor for GNOME. You can install any application you like. You can just browse the website, like Brew website, for example, for the packages available and see for yourself what you exactly like. And now let's talk about the Mac specific commands, as I said, because there are, like, there are specific commands to explore. And honestly, there are even books, interesting books written just about those Mac commands. For those people who are migrating from Linux to Mac, these are, like, top-notch tools available there. The first tool, as you can see, the open a text editor file txt. This command is really useful if you want to open a specific file using the Mac default text editor. And let's actually explore. So I'm gonna go to my desktop. I have this file. I'm gonna type open a text edit file txt. And it's gonna launch it in the default text edit. Easy as that. I actually like it. I even actually created the alias in bash rc to execute it, just like by typing textedit file txt. So you can modify the bash rc, the default configuration for the bash environment, and you are able to use this textedit thing. So which is cool. I like textedit, but you can also use the gedit. Let's say gedit file txt. Boom. It takes a while because it executes this X11 window environment from the Linux world. And if I go to about gedit, as you can see, it says gedit is a small and lightweight text editor for GNOME desktop. And you actually feel like you're, like, in a Linux, right? It's like Linux apps running right in your Mac. Like, how cool is that? All right. So next thing we're going to discuss is the disk util. And let's compare, actually. So let's say this is a disk utility I have on Mac. And as you can see, guys, it shows three partitions here. It's my macOS and then a couple of partitions I have on the same internal drive. But if you type this command disk util list, it's gonna show much more partitions. Why? Because the disk utility by default hides lots of partitions. And for example, the EFI partition, the boot partition, is not shown by default. And this is the point of confusion for many people, because they expect all the partitions to be shown. Then, like, for example, they want to copy a partition and expect the system to boot, but the system doesn't boot. I even had this confusion in one of my previous videos where I was cloning my old iMac 2008 hard drive, and I was just cloning this one partition and was just wondering why system doesn't boot. Well, the system was not booting because the EFI partition was missing, and it shows the exact partition scheme, and it shows all the partitions, how it's, like, all done, like, with all the size, with specific disk identifiers, which is important to know in a Unix system. So it actually shows all the stuff like that. So I'm gonna clear the terminal. So I totally recommend this disk util tool. You can explore, there are more options. And then what else? MDLS. If you type MDLS, let's say the same file .txt, you guys, you see it shows all these attributes which is related to this file. For example, it shows there is a plain text. It shows all the time points when it was created, when it was modified, and all this stuff like that. So it's really good. MD find actually performs spotlight search. Well, if you type it, it's gonna perform a spotlight search by specific term, like what exactly you want to explore. MD util is managing spotlight data. For example, you can turn on or turn off indexing for spotlight indexing for one of your drives. It's very, very useful to, like, fine tune this one, because actually spotlight indexing might take a while. So, like, for specific drives, you might want to disable it. Like, if you don't want the search to appear configuring for your spotlight. If you don't want specific volume to show up on this spotlight, you can disable indexing, let's say. And then there's a thing called defaults. Defaults, it actually allows you to write specific entries for the applications. To be specific, it allows you to configure the application. For example, you might want to show the hidden folders on in your Finder, or you might want to disable it. Well, by using this defaults command, you can actually configure this one. If I type man defaults, is it gonna show me? Yeah, it's gonna show me what's available for there. For this one, defaults allows you read, write, and delete macOS user defaults from a command line shell. Yeah, basically there are a lot of keys available you can discover for yourself. And yeah, I'm probably gonna do a separate video like how you can change different things in your Mac system using this defaults command. And also, let's discuss the interesting system locations available in macOS 10. For example, guys, if you go to CD opt X11 bin, you can find interesting things available specific for the X window system. Let's say we're gonna explore which one. X term, I think. Yeah. And as you can see, it launches the X-Quartz system, which is basically a port of X11 Windows system for Mac. And it launches the terminal here, X-Term. And guys, what you can notice here is that, well, if you press the right click, it doesn't work, because this one is behaving like a typical Linux application, actually. And we can see this is the location it's allocated. And this is interesting. It shows like xcalc, for example. If you type xcalc, it shows you typical like xwindow calculator, which is nice, I guess. What else we have? MacPorts binaries are located in this directory. If you go to cd opt local bin and see this one here, this is like whatever was installed in the MacPorts, whatever MacPorts installed. I have a MacPorts installed, I have a Homebrew installed, so we can go to the we're in this bin right now. Do we want to launch anything from here? No, probably not. Let's explore Homebrew pocket packages. Use local Cellar. Let's see. So what's available here? Midnight Commander, nmap. Yeah, nmap is available here. And all those interesting stuff. So yeah, this is a good one to explore. Oh, htop actually available from here. Htop. So you can see like memory use and all this interesting stuff from here. And let's clear the terminal. And bashrc is default configuration file for the bash. So if we type, like, say, less bashrc, and it's gonna show my configuration, guys. So it shows like a Java location, the path for the Android SDK tools I have installed, and as I said, this alias for the text edit. So when I type the text edit, it actually executes this command, open a text edit. And a parameter here means like open in this specific application. Actually, as far as I remember, the open command is not even from the like Unix Linux world. It's more like from the next step. It what was developed before macOS. Basically, what's macOS and based on, right? Like next step, what Steve Jobs developed during his years in the next step. This is all what I wanted to show and discuss in this presentation. Guys, I hope this video was useful for you. You learned something new. You actually understood like the different package management systems available for the Mac. If you actually like this video, please consider subscribing, press the like button, and also comment like which commands are you using or you plan to use on Mac, which packages you expect to use on Mac. If you're using a specific package and you think it's really, really good and you can recommend it, please write it down below. Thank you and see you later.